Matt had to come up and look at it. That guy's amazing. He mentioned he had his notebook, and he picked it up, and he said, I'm old school. I went old school. I go old school every week. I take my notebook, and I write down notes. I got a little bit...
I told him I get nervous every single time, and I pray that that never, ever leaves me, because I know without him, I can't do anything. Some of you know this because you've heard me say it before. Some of you went through it with me. I took zero F's in high school because I couldn't stand in front of people and speak, because I was scared to death of it. I still have a fear of standing in front of people and speaking, but I have so much joy in my life when I get to come and share about my King. Last week was proof to me at the end when we had the question time about how still there is some uncertainty with us as Torah seekers when it comes to what the Father has told us is clean and unclean. I thought maybe it was just me who had these thoughts of not being sure what was what causes what, why this, why that. But thank you for sharing with me that almost all of us still have more questions than we have answers. And I'm still looking as I read these portions about the different states of being unclean and the different states of being clean and what causes each. But I think that as I read this portion this week, as I was reading this and I was going, I thought over and over and over and over and over, and I could stand up here all day and say that God is giving us a constant reminding of who we are and why we are in the condition that we are in. I have several questions in my notes that Matt answered. So maybe we can put his answers that he gave first before the question. I knew the questions. That's why it moved me so much. And I don't exactly have them in a question form, so you'll have to figure it out. But God made man to fellowship with him. God made man to worship him. He walked in the garden with man. And there was zero separation between man and God. Don't you look so forward to the day that takes place again? That there is nothing, absolutely nothing that separates, that we are walking with our Creator, praising His holy name, praising His character. But because of sin, man was and man is in an unclean state. And if we ask why, I think we can find the answer. Did this quit working too?
I have no idea what that is.
We can find the answer in these verses. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it you shall surely die. Did they die? I got a note. I got a mm-hmm. They didn't physically die, but spiritually, they died. So a yes and no is right. There was separation that came between man and the Father. I think the very instant that he ate of it. If you remember, when he came, they went to hide their shame, their nakedness, and God came and said, "Where are you?" Did God not know where Adam was? He knew where he was, but Adam, I don't think, was sure about where he was at that time. Where are you, Adam? And Adam is our physical father. I think that these portions that we're reading right now, and you know, as you've gone through them through the years, we scratch our heads and we go, "I don't understand." One of the main things that I've had over the past 5 or 6 years is a question about, what do you mean a woman's unclean when she has a baby and she has to present a sin offering? Are you trying to tell me it's a sin for a woman to have a baby? Is that the picture God's trying to show us, that it's sinful to have children? No. He's showing us the condition that we are in because of sin. And he shows us. He also shows us the provision that he makes to get us back into the condition that man was in before sin. And only he is that provision. There's nothing that you and I can do in ourselves to get us back in that state. Only through Yeshua. I believe Matt made that statement standing right here. We can do nothing in ourselves, but he has taken care of it all. It seems obvious to me that with the departure of studying Scripture for oneself, we've lost sight of what the Father is telling us as individuals. That's something. That's where we're at today, 2017. More people want somebody else to tell them what the Bible says than sit down and open up the Scripture and go to the author of that Scripture and say, "Father, I don't understand, but I call upon you, I beg you, I plead with you to give me the interpretation of what your word says. Give me the understanding, give me this discernment so I might see where I am." So many times I'm trying to have conversation and people say, "Well, let me go back and see what my pastor says about that." You know what? I want to bypass pastor and I want to go to the source. That's where we need to be. But since the departure of studying Scripture, you know, we've been trained like this. We've been trained to do this. It's time to break that habit. We've lost sight of the ugliness of sin. We have lost sight as a people of the ugliness of sin. So many people today have no idea, and believe it or not, no care about clean and unclean. That the Father is trying to show us what condition we are in and where we need to be. And lack of study. Who is it that said, was it in the book of Hosea, said, "My people perish for the lack of pastors, knowledge, for the lack of knowledge." I think clean and unclean, sin and not sin, is something that we cannot, is something that we must not take for granted. Our eternal destiny is dependent upon it. Each of the pictures of uncleanliness or uncleanness represents death. Represents death, and cleanness represents life. But these pictures of what is unclean are things that you and I encounter every day of our life. We don't know. You don't know who sat in that chair yesterday. You don't know who you've bumped into in the grocery store. We don't know. Every single day, I believe every one of us encounter some form of uncleanliness. Now, as I said last week, clean and unclean, sin and not sin is not the same thing. But what we do or do not do with these conditions can then become sin. So God has given us the Scriptures as a constant reminder of who we are and where we are. Why do we need the reminding of this? Why do we need constant reminding of this? I might offend you. That's not my meaning, but if I do, take me out back afterwards. Why do we need constant reminding? My answer is because we're knuckleheads. Just plain and simple, we're knuckleheads. Think about it. How many of you have mirrors just so you can look and see what you look like. I started to bring one. I was going to bring one, but I forgot it because, how quick it is that we forget. Have you ever been to a mirror and went, like in that instant, you changed. We forget, don't we? Well, I think God has given us Scripture as a mirror so we can know what we look like, spiritually speaking. I'm talking today about spiritual warfare. Nathan opened up the door with this last week, and I know he's not finished. Are you, Nathan? No. He said no. He's not finished because this is so important. And God gives us constant reminders. I believe he wants us to be victorious in this. And we have to understand what we look like, spiritually speaking. The Bible's filled with warning signs. Have you ever found any of them? Have you read any of the warning signs that are in the Scriptures? Again, I ask, why all these warning signs? The answer, we're knuckleheads. And we need it over and over and over. I have some signs for you that I want to show. And my first one, and when I saw that one, I thought, how many knuckleheads in this room have come up to this sign and touched it? We have a few honest people. Donna finally came up and said, yeah. Isn't that crazy? Wet paint. I'm fixing to go try on some clothes, and now I've got wet paint all over my hand. Why'd they paint this wall? And they just know that little camera's up there. So look, there's another knucklehead coming. At the mall, they paint the walls like every week just to see how many of us are going to come in and touch it. Over and over and over. If the sign said, please touch, we want your fingerprints, they ain't touching that. I had a friend up in Downsville that had a junkyard. He had all these vehicles sitting out there, and nobody ever came and bought anything. So he went and bought a bunch of signs that said, not for sale. Sold everything he had. We're knuckleheads. I'm talking about people driving. What do you mean that ain't for sale? I want it. How much? I don't care what the price is. Well, it's not for sale. I'll give you $500. Yours. It's crazy. It's crazy. We're knuckleheads. And if you look at this stuff, you'll see it. The second one I came across, keep hands clear when equipment is running. No. I'm not going to do that. These are my hands. I'll put them where I want to. There's one even better than this. It's Jacob. I'll probably get Jacob to come up here. Look, it says, you buy a lawnmower. By the time that we are where we're at, we should understand the concept of a lawnmower. There is grass standing up. We put something with a high-speed knife to cut that grass off. Well, that sticker is on your mower deck because somebody stuck their hand under there. I used to work with a guy that came, and his hand, he was like that because his whole hand was bandaged. And I asked him, I said, what happened? He said, you're not going to believe me if I tell you. He said, but I bought a new lawnmower. And I turned the deck on, and I was driving, and I wasn't sure if the blade was turning. You guessed it. He stuck his hand. I said, really? And it cut all four of those fingers off. That's the logical way to find out if your blades are turning on your lawnmower. Stick your hand in there and see. It will answer your question fast. So, what the people who make lawnmowers, they have to put this sign on there that says, don't stick your foot or don't stick your hand under here, knucklehead, because what's in here cuts. That is a true story. And look, it wasn't me.
I know some of you are thinking, he did that himself. No, I have mine. There was a lot that I could get out there, but this one really caught my attention because we're in spiritual war. Deadly manure gases. Deadly manure gases. Think about that one. Danger, danger. Death may be immediate. Can y'all see that back there? Deadly manure gases. Gases, not glasses, gases. Emergency stop. I'm going to tell you what. Inside of here, there were a lot of emergency stop buttons. When my children were younger, my daughter was about 10 or 12, we went to Disney World for vacation, and we drove on over to Cocoa Beach at NASA to just go visit that. And they had, I don't remember what the machine was called, but it was like a little jet plane that went round and round and round to give you so many G's against your body. And my daughter got in one side, and maybe my nephew or maybe I got in the other side, and there's a screen that comes up that is like you're flying a jet plane, and I don't remember how, maybe 2 G's force against you. And as it was strapping in the one on the other side, there was an emergency stop button, and the thing hadn't even started yet, but my daughter was strapped in. Bam! She hit it. And so the little light went off, and the person and the attendant came over and said, "What's wrong?" And she said, "If it has an emergency stop button, I don't think I need to be riding it." True story, Tracy? You know what? If it has an emergency stop button, that means there's some stuff that you and I should not be riding. Look for them. They're there. God tells us, stay away from this. When God says, don't do this, as we were reading the portion, and it came up to the part of, about the cycle, and it said, this is God's law on how to treat this. I thought, I wonder how much different it would be if William would have read, because the words were there. And this is God's instruction. God's instruction. But because it says law, so many people want to say, well, that doesn't apply to us because the law is done away with. So is God's instruction done away with? If you think that, hit that emergency stop button and get off of that boat that you're on right now. This one right here, very profound, a warning sign. Read and understand operator's manual and all other instructions before using this equipment. What equipment could we be talking about? This equipment right here. And we use it every day. And here's the operator's instruction manual. Read instructions before using equipment. Spiritual warfare comes in many forms. Many forms. As I said, Nathan opened the door on that last week. But I think spiritual warfare comes in many forms, and many, maybe, it's because of this. Deadly manure. And Nathan opened the door last week for this. I was sitting back there somewhere around where Debbie is, and Nathan said, that's a bunch of, what? BS. And Tracy said, did he say that? And when we got back to Bethel, somebody said, oh, Nathan nailed it. And I said, he sure did. He opened the door that we can be, say, danger of the manure or the BS that's being taught in the place of Yahweh's word. And if you ever come to a place, even if it's here, if anything is taught other than the word of Yah, hit that stop button and get out. Or something much worse than your fingers or your feet being cut off will happen. In our New Testament portion today, Yeshua said, if your right hand is causing you, cut it off. If your eye is causing you to sin, pluck it out. I've had many, many discussions, even in the seminary extension, they taught, that's not what he means.
Well, I'm going to tell you what I believe. I believe Yeshua always said what he means, and he always means exactly what he says. It would be better to enter into glory with no eyes than to spend eternity in damnation with both eyes. That's what Yeshua said. And people can argue and try to explain it away, but it's manure for those who go against the word of our King. Many of the scriptures are used to be spiritual mirrors. Many are used for spiritual mirrors that we can stop and we can look and we can say, how do I look? Who should we look like? We should look just like Messiah. He came to this earth and he walked out Torah perfectly, showing us exactly how to walk. In Mark 9, I think we went through this. They were walking. They were doing works of the kingdom. Said he came to Capernaum. And when he was in the house, he asked them, what was it you disputed among yourselves on the road? But they kept silent, for on the road they had disputed among themselves who would be the greatest. And he sat down and called the 12 and said to them, if anyone desires to be first, he shall be last, and all and servant of all. Then he took a little child and set him in the midst of them. And when he had taken in his arms, he said to them, whoever receives one of these little children in my name receives me, and whoever receives me receives not me, but him who sent me. Could you believe that they disputed among themselves? That's unheard of. The disciples of Yeshua would dispute among themselves over who's the greatest. Wow. It's 2017, and I just wonder, what have we learned? We have this perfect book of instruction, and what have we learned? I've got a long ways to go. Why? Why is it that as believers, there is so much divisiveness among us? Why could that be? I read a document on Facebook, so it has to be true. And it stated that in the year 187, there were already 20 different varieties of Christianity. Put it in a language that I understand. In the year 187, there was already at least 20 denominations. Immediately, there was more and more and more divisiveness because the disciples disputed among themselves. I'm glad that doesn't happen anymore. Some of the problems that still exist today, and this is where some of the questions that Matt answered before it was asked, some of the problems that still exist today is why we might be having so much divisiveness is because we're looking for these things. You know what? If I'm looking for some sort of position, immediately I have made it all about me. And none of this can be about me. If it's not all about Him, I'm wasting my time, and I'm wasting your time. But believe it or not, there are people who are professing believers in God that are more worried about position. Ours, not His. Another one that might be recognition. Why is it so important that we receive recognition? When we come here to teach, I pray with all that I am that us, me, Matt, and Nate, that we're coming to give all recognition to the Father. But we seek recognition. We also want prestige. This is spiritual warfare, people. This is something that you and I battle some form in our life. What about this one? Power, authority. Who is the senior pastor at Beth Shalom? We have one. We do. Thank you, Harold. It's Yeshua. Yeshua. He's the senior pastor. If anybody else ever becomes that, go somewhere else. But I've had people get on to me talking about their pulpit, their congregation, their church. No, it's his. It's his. And he's the power, and he's the authority, and he's the one in position, and he's the only one that deserves recognition. And here's one that gets a lot of people: wealth. People struggle because they have not worldly goods as much as somebody else. I'm guilty of asking the questions, Father, how come I have not, when I'm seeking the kingdom and your righteousness, and I see old Harry out there who's not even seeking you at all, and he has everything. Seeking the wrong things. I believe this is just a partial list of what could be in the body that causes divisiveness amongst believers. Look what James says in James 4, 1 through 6. Where do wars and fights come from among you? Do they not come from your desires for pleasure that war in your members? You lust and do not have. You murder and covet and cannot obtain. You fight and war, yet you do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask amiss that you may spend it on your pleasures. Adulterers and adulteresses, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore wants to be the friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Or do you think that the Scripture says in vain, the Spirit who dwells in us yearns jealousy? But he gives more grace. Therefore he says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. That we need to take heed to those words. We need to take heed to those words. Now, here's my number one question. I wrote the word pride. I don't know if I have it on the... No. We have pride because of what? Because we wear zeet seats. Remember Matt up here talking about zeet seats? We have pride because we eat kosher. Maybe it's the nice little messianic kippahs that we wear. Maybe it's because, you know, I have got to be elevated above the person who only puts his tzitzits on his belt loop. I wear a tallit katan, and Harold only is a looper. I'm glad we can laugh at it. And we need to laugh at it, because if we say stupid stuff like that, we're nothing but knuckleheads. I saw a Facebook war over the katan versus the belt loop. I know that's hard to believe, but the guy on the belt looper said, I promise you, my belt loop has four corners. Argue that. And then we have the pride over the length. I wore my longest ones today. They're Jeremy's. When he wears them, they drag the ground. What other reasons could we possibly have pride that makes us think that we're elevated above other believers in Messiah? Maybe it's because we now understand that Saturday is the true Sabbath, and all those Sunday believers are going to a sinner's hell because they got the day wrong. Really? I think the list goes on and on and on and on. But you know what we should have instead of pride? We should have a heart of thankfulness that God has opened our eyes and brought us to the point that we are. And we shouldn't be lashing out at other people that are not at the same place on the path that we are. I believe with everything in my being that there are many, many people that don't believe exactly like I do, that are in the Father's hand. And he holds them as much as he holds me. And I have nothing to be proud about. Not in myself. Peter said in 2 Peter 1 through 11, Simon Peter, a bondservant and apostle of Yeshua Messiah, to those who obtained like precious faith with us by the righteousness of our God and the Savior, Yeshua HaMashiach. Grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and in of our Lord Yeshua, as his divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us by glory and virtue, by which have been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that was in the world through lust. But also for this very reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, to virtue knowledge, to knowledge self-control, to self-control perseverance, to perseverance godliness, to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness love. For if these things are yours and abound, you will be neither barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Yeshua HaMashiach. For he who lacks these things is short-sighted, even to blindness, and he has forgotten that he was cleansed from his old sins. Therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure. For if you do these things, you will never stumble. For so an entrance will be supplied to you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Yeshua, Messiah. We were forgiven our sins. Can you remember the time when you didn't wear tzitzit? Can you remember the time that you didn't keep Seventh-day Sabbath? Can you remember the time? Can you remember the time? Can you remember the time? I can. And he tells us to exercise brotherly love. Can brother and neighbor kind of go hand in hand? Matt, can brother and neighbor go hand in hand, yes or no? I got a yes from the back. And Mark 9:34 says, but they kept silent, for on the road they had disputed among themselves who would be the greatest. Miriam spoke out against Moses. Now I know, and thank you, Matt, for covering some of the questions about leprosy. Thank you for telling us that it was a result of sin. Miriam spoke out against Moshe, and whatever form that may, she became leprous, and she got put outside of the camp. Satan wanted to be like Yah. So he was kicked out of glory. Adam, remember what Satan said to Adam and Eve? God knows that in the day that you eat of this, you will be like him. So something tells me they had a desire to be like him. They ate and they were kicked out of the garden. So there's something that goes with people that want to be the greatest. We get kicked out of the presence of God. We need to be humble. We need to be seeking him. Those things that I listed, we need to combat them in our lives, because they're present in our lives today. We're Torah seekers, so we still have these issues that come along. This is spiritual warfare. Be thankful of who you are, more thankful of whose you are. Remember this, what it said in Mark 9:35. He sat down, called the 12 and said to them, if anyone desires to be first, he shall be last of all and the servant of all. These are pretty, pretty profound words. Did you have something before I go further? I'm going to close out this part with a song by Jason Gray. Remind me of who I am, and then we'll have the question and answers.